Hello, Coventry. I'm Francis Collins. I had the privilege of leading the Human Genome Project. I'm intensely interested in the topic of science and faith. And right now, I'm the director of the National Institutes of Health in the United States, which keeps me unfortunately awfully busy. And that's my excuse for not being with you in person. Instead, I'm speaking to you from my kitchen and hoping that these words will be of some use in this remarkable set of talks that are happening there at Coventry. So who am I? It's probably good to give you a little glimpse of my childhood, how I ended up in the circumstance you see now. I grew up on a farm in the Shenandoah Valley of Virginia. My parents were doing the 60s thing, except it wasn't the 60s yet. Living on a farm with outdoor plumbing and no animals to help with the farm work. So it was a lot of work. And basically, I grew up interested in almost everything. But then I ended up going to public school and discovered science in the form of a chemistry class and decided that's what I want to do. I want to be a chemist. Went to college, majored in chemistry, went off and got a PhD in quantum mechanics, which was really exciting stuff. And along the way, became pretty disinterested in anything that had to do with spiritual perspectives. From my view, the only thing that really mattered was science figuring out truth about nature. But I also discovered along the way that I'd kind of missed out on another branch of science, and that was biology. I'd ignored it. It seemed much too messy. And it is kind of messy, but incredibly interesting. And realizing that I had missed that opportunity to explore that and discovering that really interesting things were happening with biology, I changed my direction and went to medical school. I know, this doesn't seem like a linear pathway. Well, it wasn't. I would not recommend this to anybody as an efficient way to get to your permanent career. But I did love medicine once I got into this. And it was science, but it was about the human body. It had the promise that maybe something interesting would happen in terms of coming up with answers to diseases that we didn't understand. So I felt like I could be a medical researcher. That's what I'd really like to do. But what kind of research? Well, in that first year of medical school, I had a professor who came and taught just 6 lectures, but it was about genetics, about how this study of DNA and inheritance was beginning to shed light in terms of the ways in which all of these revelations might actually help people. And he brought patients to class, and I decided that's what I want to do. I want to be a medical geneticist, whatever that is. There weren't very many of them, and some people thought I was nuts, but it was this passion that emerged. That's what I want to do. So I proceeded down that path. At this point, I was an atheist, figuring that there was no reason outside of the scientific method to worry about any other kinds of truth. But then something happened. I found myself in the clinical part of medical school, sitting at the bedside of good people who were facing the potentially end of their life. And I realized in that situation, I would be very hard pressed to know how to deal with that. And some of these people who had remarkable faith really seemed very strong. They weren't shaking their fist at God. They were at peace. And one day, a patient of mine, a wonderful young woman, who was facing the end of her life, told me about her faith and then asked me, "So, doctor, what do you believe?" And in that moment, I realized I had no idea. I had never given any really serious consideration to the question, is there a God? And if so, does that God care about me? And what happens after you die? All those things were things I had avoided. I was practicing what you might call willful blindness. I didn't want to look at those issues. But her question unsettled me deeply, and I felt I have to go and learn more about this. There must be reasons why people believe. I assumed it was all superstition. But as I began to talk to people who were believers and a good pastor who lived down the street and listened to my blasphemous questions pointed me to things that I might read, one of them was C.S. Lewis's book called Mere Christianity. And I was blown away. Here was this Oxford scholar who, like me, had been an atheist and then began to explore the evidence for faith and realized that there was a lot there that was hard to ignore. And who also recognized that in many ways, atheism is the most irrational of all the choices. What Chesterton calls the most daring of all dogmas. the assertion of a universal negative. Scientists aren't supposed to do that. And so I began to consider whether I might have been wrong about this, still imagining that ultimately this search for truth would lead me back to atheism. It didn't. I found out there were things about nature that I had kind of ignored that were pointers towards something much bigger than myself. There was, in fact, this question of why is there something at all? Why is there something instead of nothing? The ultimate philosophical question. Science doesn't have any answer to that. And then there is this wonderful universe, but it had a beginning, which suggests that there must have been a creator that is not limited in space and time. Otherwise, you can't solve the question of how did this get started? Well, that sounds like a creator God. And then when you began looking at the universe, my goodness, all the time I had spent as a student of quantum mechanics, I loved those equations that described matter and energy. How could it be that those actually worked? It suggests that there's an intelligence and a very impressive intelligence behind all this, a mathematician, a physicist. And then, maybe the most compelling, this sense that the way in which the universe works, the way that those constants that determine everything from gravity to the mass of the electron have to have exactly the exact size and shape and value that they do, otherwise the whole thing doesn't work. It falls apart. Of all the possible universes that might have happened, we happen to be in the only one where any of this would be at all interesting. Otherwise, it would be monotonous, formless, senseless, particles all through the rest of all time. And yet, that's not the way it is. So one has to begin to say, somebody, some incredible wise intelligence, has set the dials. And that was a shock to me. And it certainly made it difficult to stick to my strict atheistic perspective. But then there was the question of, okay, that might get you to the point of recognizing a creator that you might call a deist God, a God who set everything together, but then maybe wandered off to do something else. What about a God who cares about me? Well, there again, when I began to look at the evidence, I realized something that I had never given consideration to, because it was just like breathing the air. And that was this sense that we all have as human beings about good and evil. What is it that could account for the fact that we have this thing called the moral law? All cultures have had it. They disagree about how it applies, but no culture has ever said there's no such thing as good and evil. They have their definitions about what they're doing being good and somebody else is evil. And I began to realize there's no real reason for that to be there that I can come up with scientifically. And if you were looking for evidence of a God who wasn't just interested in the universe as a bland, featureless, spiritless thing, but actually interested in having relationship with creatures, maybe even creatures in God's image, and you found in yourself this sense of good and evil, wouldn't that be an interesting signpost to a God who cares about you? And not just any old signpost, but a signpost that points to God's character, which must be good and holy, more so than we ever can imagine. That shook me up, this existence of the moral law. Again, I come back to Lewis, that first chapter of Mere Christianity. What's the title of it? It's called Right and Wrong as a Clue to the Meaning of the Universe. Okay, I got the clue. But then I began to feel this sense of concern about what that said, because if there is a God, and God cares about me, and God expects me to be good and holy and not to do the evil thing, I had to be honest that I wasn't very good at that. And that just as I was beginning to appreciate that there might be a God, that God seemed to be getting further away from who I was. How was I going to solve that? Into that gloom came the bright character of Jesus Christ. God reaching out to me, God sending Jesus as the substitution for my failures, Jesus who became man but also was God, and who by his sacrifice built a bridge so that I could in fact approach this good and holy God and not feel completely hopeless. That made perfect sense. All the things I had heard from believers when I was growing up, which I thought was just so much nonsense, about Jesus died for your sins, now it made perfect sense. Okay, well, an atheist would say, that's all fine, but this stuff about the moral law, that's really just something that comes out of the fact that being good has provided opportunities for all of us to live longer and reproduce and pass along our DNA. It's just all evolutionary pressure. That doesn't work for me. Because if that's true, that basically says good and evil are not real concepts at all. We've been hoodwinked and by some sort of biological conspiracy to believe that they matter. Now, even I think the strictest atheists have a really hard time with that one. Morality has to have a basis. Otherwise, it doesn't fit together at all with what we all experience. And where could that basis come from? I don't see how it comes from culture. I don't see how it comes from anything inside ourselves, which requires us then to look outside. And there again, I land squarely in the presence of a God who cares about good and evil. Well, as I became a believer, people around me suspected that my head was going to explode, because here I was, as a physician, a geneticist interested in DNA, and all of a sudden I thought God was involved in this. That now has been 42 years since I made that transition from atheist to Christian, and I've never found a problem here. And it troubles me greatly that so many people see these as worldviews that are in conflict. I think the conflict is one that we humans have managed to create quite nicely, but I do not believe it's baked at all into the fundamental truths of science and fundamental truths of faith. As long as you're careful about making sure what kind of question you're asking, you can find truth. Now, these are the two books that God gave us, the book of God's words, the Bible, and the book of God's works, nature. And those books can't very well be in conflict. And if they are, or if we think they are, we've probably made some kind of error in our interpretation or one or the other. For me, as a scientist, the coolest part of science is DNA. So let me say a word about that. I have had the privilege of leading the Human Genome Project, an international effort which in the space of 13 years read out all the letters of the human DNA instruction book, written in this remarkable script, this incredible way of passing information from generation to generation. And this DNA language, which is true of all living organisms, is the way in which digitally all that is encoded. And it's an elegant language. It has just four letters in its alphabet. And if you took that particular script for a human being, it takes 3 billion of those letters to read out the instruction book for human biology. If you stacked pages together where you had printed that out from one cell of the body, it would be about 600 feet tall. And you have all that information inside each cell of your body delivered to you by your parents. Remarkable stuff, elegant stuff. It's hard not to be in awe of the beauty of the way in which DNA controls this passive information. But then it has to be put into action, so there's RNA and there's protein and all these metabolites. Oh my gosh, there's the brain, which has to be specified by that DNA language, with 86 billion neurons between your ears that have to do all these amazing things. You cannot be involved in science and not be in awe every day. And some people who are believers say, well, isn't science kind of knocking back the awe by understanding how this works from time to time? And I would say, no, not at all. It adds to my awe. Science is also a way of uncovering the amazing majesty and beauty of God's creation. And so as a scientist, I can also be a worshiper when I discover something that wasn't known before. Now, people will ask, can you in fact look at life and see that that might actually have happened from natural processes? Or doesn't this require there to be a supernatural intervention, especially in getting the whole thing started? And it's a great question, and we don't know the answer. Nobody quite knows how life first began on this planet. There are theories. It might have been RNA instead of DNA. We don't really know. People are doing experiments trying to replicate that environment to see if there might be some pathway where you start out with a lot of inanimate chemicals and you end up with something that can replicate itself. I don't know. It's possible. God had to step in and do it. But it's also possible, and maybe even more amazing, that God set all those parameters at the beginning of the universe in such a precise way that the arrival of this kind of life on this blue planet was inevitable by the way in which the whole plan had been put in motion. That seems like even more amazing. Because after all, God designed the natural laws. Maybe it's not in God's best interest to intervene with those natural laws too often. So if he could do it all by the original plan, that is just amazing. So I don't know the answer, but I would hope nobody would get hung up on that. One of the things that people like me who are scientists and believers get worried about is when somebody says, well, here's a place that science hasn't understood yet, so that must be what God did. And then science comes along and makes advances, and now it starts to be clear that maybe there was a way we could understand that. That's a God of the gaps approach we should be careful about. But there are parts of our understanding of what we live within in this universe that science really isn't going to help us with, and we can hang on to those. Why do I believe in God? Why am I, as a scientist who's had this amazing experience uncovering all these mysteries about life, why am I also a follower of Jesus? It just doesn't make sense otherwise to put this all together. I would feel so impoverished if only the scientific perspective was how I put answers to questions together. Because there'd be questions I simply would have to say, well, they're off the table. Why am I here? Is that a scientific question? Science doesn't help me so much there. Is there a God? What happens after you die? What's the nature of beauty, and why do we care about that? What about love? Is there something about science that's going to really help you understand the most altruistic, sacrificial kinds of love? The love that causes somebody to lay down their life for another person, even somebody they don't know. Those things scientifically remain mysteries, and I think always will. But from a faith perspective, when I go and see what Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount, it all falls beautifully together. So to have the chance then to live this sort of fully realized life of bringing all those ways of understanding truth together and not having to compartmentalize them over here or over there, that has been a joyful way for me to have the chance to live this life of science and of faith. And it's wonderful when I encounter other people who share that same sense of joy. Unfortunately, all too often in our culture, we have not seen that potential for harmony. There's been a lot of sense that there's a conflict here, and there's certainly loud voices coming from both extremes here, either saying that science is not to be trusted because it disagrees with an interpretation of a particular scriptural verse, or on the other hand, that faith is not to be trusted because science is the only thing that matters, and those faith people, they're always coming up with stuff that you can't prove. I think most of us don't really see it that way. I think most people feel like there is something here from both perspectives that we want to embrace, we want to internalize, we want to wrap our arms around. The good news is they're right. There is such a harmony. You can find it. I have found it. I hope in this wonderful Coventry series there will be more and more opportunities for people to understand just how these worldviews fit together into something that is truly beautiful, truly awesome, truly inspiring, truly gratifying, and truly gives us all joy. Thank you.